Good night, everyone. We're going to be starting with a word of prayer.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us back to another night. Thank you for everything you've given to us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We're going to be starting with hymn number 253. There's no other name like Jesus. Hymn number 253. There's no other name like Jesus. It's the dearest name we know. It's the angels' joy in heaven. It's the Christian's joy below. Sweet name, dear name. There's no other name like Jesus, sweet name, dear name. There's no other name like Jesus. There's no other name like Jesus. When the heart with grief is sad, there's no other name like Jesus. When the heart is free and glad. Sweet name, dear name. There's no other name like Jesus. Sweet name, dear name. There's no other name like Jesus. It's the hope that I shall see him when in glory he appears. It's the hope to hear his welcome that my fainting spirit shares. Sweet name, dear name. There's no other name like Jesus. Sweet name, dear name. There's no other name like Jesus. If he wills that I should labor in his vineyard day by day, then 'tis well if only Jesus is my dying trust and stay. Sweet name, dear name. There's no other name like Jesus. Sweet name, dear name. There's no other name like Jesus. If he wills that death's cold finger touch my feeble mortal clay, then 'tis well if only Jesus is my dying trust and stay. Sweet name, dear name. There's no other name like Jesus. Sweet name, dear name. There's no other name like Jesus. Let's do hymn number 183. I will sing of Jesus' love. Hymn number 183.
I will sing of Jesus' love, sing of him who first loved me, for he left bright words above and died on Calvary. I will sing of Jesus' love and let's praise. My heart shall give, he has died, that I might live. I will sing his love to me, oh, the death of divine earth or heaven can never know how to sing. As dark as mine can be made as white as snow, I will sing of Jesus' love and the praise. My heart shall give me as that, that I might live. I will sing is up to me, nothing good for him I've done. How could he such love bestow? Lord, I hope my heart is one. Help me now my love to show. I will sing of Jesus' love and his praise. My heart shall give me as that, that I might live. I will sing his love to me.
Hymn number 185, Jesus is all the world to me. Hymn number 185.
Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my whole. He is my strength from day to day. Without him I will fall. When I am sad to him I go. No other one can cheer me so. When I am sad, he makes me glad. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, my friend in trials sore. I go to him for blessings, and he gives them more and more. He sends the sunshine and the rain. He sends the harvest cold and grain. Sunshine and rain, harvest of grain. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, and true to him I'll be. Oh, how could I this friend deny when he's so true to me? Following him, I know I'm right. He watches over me day and night. Following him, night and night, he's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me. I want no better friend. I trust him now. I'll trust him when life's fleeting day shall end. Beautiful life with such a friend. Beautiful life that has no end. Eternal life, eternal joy. He's my friend.
Hymn number 195. Shores of blessing. Hymn number 195.
There shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessing. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drop from the star falling. But for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, precious reviving again. Over the hills and the valleys, sound of abundance of rain. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops from the star falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, send them upon us, O Lord. Now grant to us now a refreshing. Come and honor thy word. Showers of blessing. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops from the star falling. But for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing. Oh, that today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing, now as on Jesus we call. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops from the star falling, but for the showers we plead.
Hymn number 205, Gleams of the Golden Morning. Hymn number 205.
The golden morning is fast approaching. Jesus soon will come to take his faithful and happy children to their promised home. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning that will burst the tomb. The gospel summons will soon be carried to the nations round. The bridegroom then will cease to tarry and the trumpet sound. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning that will burst the tomb. Attended by all the shining angels down the flaming sky, the judge will come and will take his people where they will not die. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning that will burst the tomb. There are those of ones who have long been parted will all meet that day. The tears of those who are brokenhearted will be wiped away. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning that will burst the tomb.
Let's do hymn number 254, The Great Physician Now Is Here. Hymn number 254.
The great physician now is here, the sympathizing Jesus. He speaks the truth in heart to cheer. Oh, hear the voice of Jesus. Sweetest more than Sarah's song. Sweetest name on mortal tongue. Sweetest carol ever sung. Jesus, blessed Jesus. All glory to the dying Lamb. I now believe in Jesus. I love the blessed Savior's name. I love the name of Jesus. Sweetest note in Sarah's song. Sweetest name on mortal tongue. Sweetest carol ever sung. Jesus, blessed Jesus. His name dispels my guilt and fear. No other name but Jesus. Oh, how my soul delights to hear the precious name of Jesus. Sweetest note in seraph song, sweetest name on mortal tongue, sweetest carol ever sung, Jesus, blessed Jesus. And when he comes to bring the crown of life and glory, then by his side we will sit down and tell redemption story. Sweetest note in Sarah's song, sweetest name on mortal tongue, sweetest carol ever sung, Jesus, blessed Jesus.
Let's do hymn number 312, Near the Cross.
Jesus, keep me near the cross, near the precious fountain, free to all a healing stream flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. than the cross of trembling soul. Love and mercy found me, there the bright and morning star sheds its beams around me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. There the cross, O Lamb of God, bring its scenes before me. Help me walk from day to day with its shadows o'er me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. There the cross I'll watch and wait, hoping, trusting ever, till I reach that golden shrine just beyond the river. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river.
Our opening hymn will be hymn number 205, Gleams of the Golden Morning.
The golden morning is fast approaching. Jesus soon will come to take his faithful and happy children to their promised home. Oh, we see the glimpse of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. Oh, we see the glimpse of the golden morning that will burst the tomb. The gospel summons will soon be carried to the nations round. The bridegroom then will cease to tarry and the trumpet sound. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning that will burst the tomb. Attended by all the shining angels down the flaming skies, the judge will come and will take his people where they will not die. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning that will burst the tomb. There those loved ones who have long been parted will all meet that day. The tears of those who are brokenhearted will be wiped away. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning piercing through this night of gloom. Oh, we see the gleams of the golden morning that will burst the tomb.
Thank you all for singing with us. See you guys again on Wednesday night.
Hey, good night, everybody. We are very happy that you have joined us tonight. I want to thank my daughters for leading us in those lovely songs. I have with me tonight, Ella Shane. We're very happy to have you tonight. Thank you for joining us. And it's a very, very interesting time that we are living in here, an exciting time. I hope that you had a nice day today.
Mm-hmm.
Had some time with the family. All right. Thank you for being here with us tonight. We don't have Ella Travis with us. We'll just keep him in prayer. But God always have him. All right.
Sure.
Shane, would you like to say something to those who are listening tonight before we move into our program?
And all those who are listening to us tonight, we're glad to have you guys. And it is always a pleasure and a privilege when we can, even though we can't be together, but we can always, when it comes to studying God's word, it's always a pleasure and a privilege for us to be in the same mind frame. And so tonight, I am so glad that you guys would take all the time to listen to us. And we hope and pray that tonight you guys will receive a blessing from what we have to say tonight.
Amen. Thank you. I know, Latin, today it was confirmed that we had the first death because of COVID-19 here in Belize, which really is sad. From the time all this started taking place, it has caused me to reflect on what's taking place on my life. And just imagine how these people who have lost loved ones, and the sad part is that they cannot be with their loved one as they die. Some of them don't get to bury them. It's a really, really sad situation. And it's coming nearer home to us. We look on the news and we see it taking place in other places throughout the world. But now it has hit home to us here in Belize. I'm not sure, what is your thought upon that?
Pastor, when I found out about it today, I told my wife, I said, we have seen it on the TV and you know, on YouTube and on the TV, and we have seen how places like New York and Italy and China and all these places have been struggling when it comes to this virus. And we went from having our first case to our second case, and now we are actually experiencing our first death. And so I told my wife today, I said, I hope and pray that this somehow became a reality to all of us as Belizeans, that we realize that this virus is something that is a respecter of no person.
That's true.
And so we have heard on TV where so much people died in New York currently, and for us here in Belize, we are taking for granted as though we might, our first case and so forth, we might be able to pass through. But the first death today, like what you said, made a reality that, you know what, that might be the first death. But if we here in Belize, if we don't get our act together, if we don't comply with the government, if we don't rely on God as our sustainer, that's just one in many that we're going to experience. And so my plea to my fellow Belizean is that for us to take this serious. Let us not take it lightly. Let us comply with the rules and regulation, especially as Christians. This shouldn't be a problem for us because we need to comply. Because when Christ was on earth, he also complied with the rules and regulation that was set up. And so as Christians, we need to comply as with the rules and regulation when it comes to what the government is setting in place.
So true. You know, people there's a lot of suffering taking place in our world tonight. A lot. Every day you look on the news and you hear so much have died, so much have gotten infected today. And it's not only that. It's not only the infection. It's not only those who are dying. It's also financial challenges. Being separated from loved ones, people have lost their jobs. Some people mentally, they are going through a lot of difficulties. So it's not just the death, it's not just the sickness. We are having financial issues as well. And you know, as long as you have financial issues, it's going to affect everyone. Yep. As you rightly said earlier, this disease is not a respecter of persons. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter who we are, what nation we come from, what race, what religion we belong to. as long as we come in contact with someone who have it and we're not taking care of ourselves, we're going to get infected as well. Mm-hmm. So the question is tonight, will this ever come to an end? Will this ever come to an end? We are not the bearer of bad news, Elashane. We are the bearer of good news.
Amen.
Despite of what's in place, I thank God for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And this is why the gospel is given. It was given so that we would find hope in a time of hopelessness. When everything seems to be crumbling, there is still somebody that we can turn to and something that we can hold on to. And it's not as though we're holding on to fables. We're holding on to truth and something that is a reality. To start our study, there is a scripture that I would like to read to just remind our listeners tonight what the Bible has to say. In the book of Revelation chapter 21, verse 4 and Revelation chapter 21, yes. And I would like to read verse 3 and 4, sorry. The scripture says, John, he was in vision, and John says, "And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them. They shall be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. Mm-hmm. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall not be no more pain, for the former things have passed away."
Amen.
John, seeing in vision, he said, "I saw a new heaven and I saw a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth have passed away," he says, "and God will make everything new." Jesus also says, on this earth, we will have tribulation. We're going to have difficulty. And one of the mistakes, Elashane, that people make is seeking peace here on this earth. I'm not saying that we're not supposed to work towards peace. We are supposed to, but the Bible says when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction. So it is not wise for us to try to find our peace here. Our peace is only found in Christ, the Prince of Peace, that he gives within. Okay? Now, what is your thought concerning that?
I like the part where it talks about, where it says, in chapter 3, he says, "And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them." Like the part that where it talks about God dwelling with us. You know, like you had mentioned, you know, there are times, like currently, there are a lot of people who are here in Belize and all over the world that are at the point of discouraged because there is no vaccine, there is no treatment for this virus, and there are people who are in point of distress. But the scripture told us that God is going to be with us.
Amen.
And hence the reason, whatever we might be going through on a personal level, it is encouraging to know that we have a God that is going to be with us. Like what the song says, "One set of footprint in the sand. Oh, yeah. All this while you were carrying me." Right. And so, even though there are times when it feels as though we are going through a lot and God is distant from us, that's the time when God is the closest to us. And once we realize and acknowledge that, then we will find the strength and we will find that encouragement to know that God is right next to me when I'm going through a rough time. I'm not going through this all by myself, but God is right there with me as I'm facing this trials and tribulation, you know.
So true. So true. You know, as we enter our study, last week we started the study talking about the second coming of Christ, which is the ultimate deliverance.
Mm-hmm.
This is part two, and we're going to continue where we left off last week. And for those who are listening last week and are joining with us, know what we're talking about. And those who are just joining us for the first time, you weren't here listening last week, we were talking about the second coming of Christ. Now, this might sound like a fable or something that is made up of men. We established that the Bible is not man-made. The things that are in there are true. I think it was Peter that says we have a sure word of prophecy, whereby we do well that we take heed. All right? And the Bible have shown us last week in John 14, 1, 2, and 3, Jesus says that he go to prepare a place for us and that he will come back again. All right? And that was established. He didn't say, maybe I will come or I will think about it. He said, I will come again. He made us a promise that if I go, I will come back again. And so he came the first time as a baby in Bethlehem. He lived a perfect life. He was our example in his life. He died for us. He suffered, was buried, resurrected, ascended to the Father, sat at the right hand of the Father, became our advocate, our intercessor. He also is our high priest, but he will not remain there forever, as we learned last week. We learned that there is a second coming. And when he comes back the second time, he will not come as a baby in Bethlehem, but he will come back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And in the book of Revelation, he says in verse chapter 22, I believe it's verse 14, where he says that, behold, I come quickly and my reward is with me to give every man. So that's good news for those who are waiting for him. But as we will learn tonight, it is going to be bad news for some people as well. All right. We also learn the manner in which Christ would come. We learn that when he come, every eye will see him, says Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7. He will not come secretly, no secret rapture, as is being preached by many today, that he will just come and snatch his people away. And that is not biblical. The Bible shows us clearly that when Christ come, in the book of Matthew chapter 24 and verse 30, the scripture says that we will see him coming from the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. In the book of Psalms, the psalmist David said, our Lord will come and will not keep silent. He will come with thunder and noise and lightnings and earthquakes. So there is nothing secret about the coming of Christ. Just as how he ascend, he will descend back, coming down from heaven. All right? It will be visible to everyone when they come. And we also learn who will be with him when he comes. And we are at this presently. Who all will be coming with Jesus when he comes? Ella Shane, would you like to elaborate on that for us? Number four.
Well, it says, if you look in the book of Matthew chapter 5, verse 31, it talks about there will be a host of angels. And I like the fact that it is saying that that it won't be only Jesus himself that will be coming, but it will be such a joyous time that heaven will be pretty much empty, right? Yes. Because it's not only Christ that's going to be welcoming his people, but also the angels will be there to accompany Jesus as he comes back for his people, which is like you know, when you're at a basketball game and you're playing basketball, and when you have the entire entourage cheering on you, you know, they're cheering you on. It motivates you to want to do better. It motivates you to want to perform better. And so when it comes, Christ come back for us, and it says that in Matthew 25:31, it says that he's coming with the host, not just one angel or two angel or three angel, but with the entire angel, with the entire angel body, he'll be coming with, and that will be escorting Christ as he comes back and take his people home with him, which is a means of encouragement to me, you know? So I'm glad to hear that, right?
Oh, yes. It's so true. Revelation chapter 1 says that there was silence in heaven for the space of half hour. And why would heaven be silent? Why wouldn't there be any noise in heaven? The reason for that, the prophecy shows us is because heaven will be empty. All the angels will be coming with him. The Father will be coming with him. The Holy Ghost will be coming with him. Mm-hmm. So everybody will come. This is a climactic event. This is a great event. It is the greatest event that will ever take place here in our universe and in our little planet called Earth. Okay, and we look forward to that time. Okay, as I stated before, the purpose of Jesus coming, he will come to save his people and to reward every man according to their works, right? The question is asked, what will happen to the righteous people when Jesus comes the second time? What will happen to the righteous people when Jesus comes the second time? Would you like to help us with that?
And you had mentioned earlier, Pastor, that it will be, when Christ comes the second time, it will be a glorious time for those who await his coming, right? All those who await his coming will be excited because this is something that we have been waiting for. This is something that we have been preparing for. But what about those who, like what you are saying, who might not have opportunity to wait for him, right? So what will happen to, like what you had mentioned, what will happen to the righteous people when Jesus comes back? It says that all those people will be, this will be their time where they could actually, everything that you have worked for, all the sacrifice you have put in, all the time that you have committed when it seemed as though when people put you down, when it seemed as though people call you names and you are still faithful to God, this will be the time where you would actually be able to see the hard work pay off. And it says that this will be a time when the dead in Christ will rise first, right? The dead in Christ will rise first. All those who died in Christ serving God, this will be a time where they will have the opportunity to ascend to heaven. And also, it will also be a time where the ones that are alive would have opportunity to be caught up in the air with the others who had died. And so this will be an awesome time where we are preparing ourselves that we would be able to go back with Christ when he comes the second time, right?
Amen. So true. And there have always been two classes of people on this earth. Mm-hmm. So if you remember at the beginning of time, Adam and Eve had two sons, Cain and Abel. Mm-hmm. The scripture said that Cain killed his brother because of jealousy. All right? These two represents the two classes of people that will exist throughout every generation. Abel did exactly what God asked him to do. God asked them to offer a sacrifice, which was a lamb. Abel, who was a shepherd, brought the lamb. Cain was a farmer, and he brought some fruits and vegetables. I believe he brought the best fruits and vegetables that he had, but that's not what God asked for. Okay? He wanted to give God what he believed God would accept, or what was convenient for him, instead of simply following what God says. So we have the obedient and the disobedient. Okay? In every generation, we'll have only two classes of people. Those who will be obedient to God and his commandments, and those who are disobedient to God and his commandments. In coming right down to the last generation, just before the second coming of Christ, in our time as well, we have those who want to serve Christ and those who they hear about Christ, but they're not really into that, okay? They're more into pleasure, enjoying themselves, all right? Their mind is not on God. And also, when Christ comes, you will not only have the two classes of people, but you will also have the righteous that have died. Okay? Mm-hmm. You'll have people who have died from the time of Adam in every generation, coming right down to our generation, and you also have righteous people that will be alive when Christ comes. Now the dead will be brought back to life. So this will be a great resurrection. Elashin, there have been so many who have died in Christ and for Christ. Okay? History shows us, scripture shows us that the people of God have suffered a lot. They were never the majority. Okay? If we look in the time of the antediluvian world, out of an entire world, only 8 people were saved. Noah, his wife, his 3 sons, and their wives. Okay? And someone brought it to my attention. If you notice, not even a child was saved, which was sad. It's only adults. Okay? And in the time of Sodom and Gomorrah, out of 2 cities, only 3 were saved. All right? And when you look in the book of Revelation chapter 20 and verse 9, the scripture shows us that not those that will be lost will be like the sands of the sea. So those that will be lost will be greater than those that are saved. But the good news that we bring is that there will be those that will be saved. And God will bring back those who died in him back to life. Look how many people are dying. Okay? Yeah. I always ask the question, how much of these people who have given up their breath and have closed their eyes have really made things right with God? They have been ushered into eternity. And many of us believe that that is the end of it. And we believe that everyone that dies go to heaven despite the life that they live. And that's a lie. When Jesus comes, he's going to bring back his people, those who have died, bring them back to life. And those who are alive when he comes. That's another good point, Ella Shane, that nobody will destroy this earth but Christ himself. No nuclear weapon, no terrorist who is going to destroy this earth. It's not going to be destroyed by COVID-19. Christ himself will put an end to this world. But God will have people that will be alive when he comes. And that should give us hope, right? Amen. Anything to add on that?
Pastor, I like you hit that point there. I was talking to a couple of people, and they're projecting towards, so many people will die from this virus. And so I told them, I keep telling them, the last time I read my Bible, I have never come across in the Bible where it says that this virus is going to be something that's going to destroy the world. I said, the last time I read my Bible, it said that God said that he's not going to destroy the earth by water, but by fire. So don't be confused when it comes to the numbers in terms of, but keep in mind that even though that we are faced with this challenge at this moment, that this is not the end of the world, right? That when this will be phased out, and when it is phased out, guess what? We have the sure word that God is going to be there for us. And that the fact that he had promised us that he's going to be with us even through our tough time. And so I'm thankful that we are at right now, where it talks about that there'll be the people who would be able to see Christ when Christ comes back. Hence the fact that there will be we will be going somewhere, so that this earth is not the end. When you die, it's not the end, right? So even though we have people who, family members who passed away and went to sleep, guess what? If they were faithful and if we are faithful, there will be a grand reunion when Christ returns.
That is so true. It's comforting to know that even though we have a lot that will be lost, you will have people that will be saved. And that nothing else will put an end to this world but Christ himself. You see, we fail to recognize who is in charge, Anoela Shane. Who is in charge is not world leaders. It's not President Trump that is in charge of this world, right? Mm-hmm. It is God. God is still seated upon the throne. And a divine hand is working behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. And none of these things that is happening in our world has caught him by surprise. In fact, he has warned us of these things so that when we see them, we could know that all these will come to pass, but they are pointing to one thing, is that the coming of Jesus is at hand. Okay. Next. So we have seen what will happen to the righteous. Jesus will raise those who have died, those who are alive, and together they will be caught up to meet him in the air. Remember, he'll be coming with power and great glory. All right? The next question, what will happen to the wicked people when Jesus comes again? What will happen to the wicked?
And we can, in the book of Isaiah chapter 14 and verse, I'm sorry, Isaiah chapter 11 and verse 4, it gives us an idea what will take place. Isaiah 11 and verse 4, it says that the wicked, when Christ comes back, they will be slain, they will be slain with the bread, right? With the bread of God, they will be slain. That means when Christ comes back, this will be a time where we have the two class of people, like you had mentioned earlier. The ones that have been putting in the work and have been faithful to God no matter what, those are the ones that's going to be reaping the reward of going with Christ. And then we have the wicked ones that have been tried to discourage the righteous. Those are the ones that would be I wouldn't say surprised, but they would be the one that would end up reap the consequence. So when Christ comes back, they will be the one that will be slain. They will be one that will be killed. And we can find it also in the book of Jeremiah 25, verse 33, right? That the wicked will be slain by the bread, right?
So true. So when Jesus comes, he saves his people. But on the other hand, remember there are two classes, the righteous and the wicked. Mm-hmm. What will happen to the wicked when Christ comes? As you read correctly just now, that his bread, okay, his brightness also destroys the wicked. In the book of Revelation, if you want to turn there with me, in the book of Revelation chapter 6, there is a text there from that I would like to read that describes how the wicked react when they see Jesus coming again, right? In Revelation chapter 6, when I look at the Bible have all the answers for us. We just need to read it. It's there. God have revealed these things to us so that we would know and be prepared. In Revelation chapter 6, I will be reading verse 12 onward. The scripture says, I looked when he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood. The stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late fig when it is shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll and rolled back when it is rolled up. And every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the kings of the earth and great men and the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, and every slave and every free man hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us. Hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. The great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand? So here, they open the sixth seal, and under the sixth seal is talking about people running, hiding as Christ comes the second time, and it describes it that the sky rolled back as a scroll, and every mountain and island move out of its place. It says that there was a great earthquake, and people just running because they're afraid. All right, Jesus does not want anybody to be afraid of him. The truth is, he's a God of love.
Amen.
But he have tried. These people that will run from him on that day are those who he have tried to reach in various ways. People come and try to share Christ with us. They come to our house. Sometimes we push them off. They send us a text. We don't read that. Let's take, for example, we're here on social media. presenting the word of God for these last days, and some pass and see probably, and there are other interesting things that take up people's attention on social media, on the television, and God will bring it back to them and show them that, you know what, I've tried to reach you. So anybody that will be lost will not be lost because God did not want to save them. Is that mm-hmm. God offered them salvation and they rejected that great salvation that Christ have offered to them. All right? So mm-hmm. on that day, then there will be those who are alive but have not chose to serve Christ that will be afraid, that will try to run and hide from the face, because we need to remember that God is a holy God. And as sinners, we cannot stand in the presence of a holy God. The only way the righteous will stand is because they have accepted Christ. He has changed their bodies, given them new bodies, so they can stand in the presence of God. But the wicked will try to run and hide, but his breath will slay them. His brightness will slay them as well. All right? And remember, there will be those who have died as well who did not accept Christ. What will happen to these people? What will happen to them? Could you share with us?
I believe that those who have died that haven't served Christ, they too would also be able to see him, right? And also because they will need to be able to see that this is actually the one that I've been rejecting. Right? I believe that Christ would when Christ comes back, they too would be somehow get a chance to see him, to see that yes, to see him in his true nature. Not just this carpenter's son, but in his true glory and nature. But because in the end, the Bible did say that all eyes will see him, not just some, but all eyes will be able to behold him and see his true nature, right?
Just to add to what you're saying, Elashim, the Bible in the book of St. John chapter 5, 28 and 29 talks about two resurrections, okay? Mm-hmm. St. John 5, 28 and 29 said there are two resurrections, a resurrection of the righteous, and there is the resurrection of the wicked, right? Mm-hmm. And the resurrection of the righteous takes place first at mm-hmm. the second coming of Christ. So when Christ comes, the righteous will come back to life. The mm-hmm. wicked, according to the Bible, in Revelation chapter 20, it shows that the wicked remains in the grave, okay, until the second resurrection. Then they will come forth mm-hmm. and they will see Christ indeed, as what you said. Mm-hmm. But at the second coming of Christ, they remain in their graves, all right? They remain in the grave, and when Christ come after the 1,000 years is when they come back to life. As you said, mm-hmm. every eye will see him. They will see him coming down with the new Jerusalem, all right? And that's when God poured judgment down on his people, mm-hmm. all right? So it is not the will of God for anybody to be lost. I believe that God wants all of us to be saved. And this is why in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 14, it says that the gospel is going to be preached to all the world for a witness, then the end will come. It didn't say that everybody is going to accept Elashim. Mm-hmm. It says that we will preach for a witness, that everyone will get the opportunity to hear, because God is trying to reach humanity. And he tried in various ways, in the printed word. The Bible is so common, it's one of the most common books you can find. You can get your hand on it to read it. On television, the gospel is being preached on social media in many ways. I'm not sure if you can share any other way that you see God is trying to reach people. Would you like to share with us?
I don't want to say I am grateful for this virus, But I believe that this virus has, the enemy meant it for bad, but God is actually using as a means of good. Us, with us being on this, on Facebook and social media, we are reaching a lot of people. We are actually, in fact, I'm actually seeing people actually is leading towards more going back to church.
Yes,
sir. And as what you had mentioned, when it comes to the gospel being preached, is that God will use whatever means, whatever the enemy meant for bad, he's going to use it for his glory and glory. And so this means of us using social media as a means of reaching others, as a means of he would use sending out a text, he would use whatever means and ways that we can to reach other people, right? And I believe that he wants this message to go out in the sense that it would, that nobody have an excuse. Because what if somebody never heard the message, like us being on social media right now? We are reaching people that we could have never reached while we were in the church.
So true.
Right? And so that individual that's listening to us currently, that could have never heard myself or you, pastor, preach at church, that individual that is listening to us on Facebook does not have an excuse now to say, I didn't hear the word. Because on that day, God will look at them and say, you know what? During this time, this church was doing this. So you was there present and you actually here. So with this, it is telling us that these things are set up because nobody will have an excuse to say, Lord, I never get an opportunity to be actually here. Right? And so hence the reason God is asking us to spread the message. Use whatever means and media we can use as a way of letting people know of about him, so that they don't have an excuse when that time comes, when Christ returns.
So true, Elashim. I, as I always said, I don't believe that the COVID-19 is something that God originated. Mm-hmm. In fact, the scripture says in Ephesians chapter 6, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but spiritual mm-hmm. wickedness in heaven. Mm-hmm. The devil is working behind the scenes, mm-hmm. and the devil uses his instruments just as how God uses his instruments. Mm-hmm. You see, there is a war taking place presently in our world between mm-hmm. the powers of light and darkness, between mm-hmm. Christ and Satan. And every human being on this planet, whether you make that decision or not, we're on the side of Christ or on the side of Satan. There is no middle mm-hmm. ground. And the devil is trying his best to destroy as much as possible and cause people to die without Christ. Do you know how much the devil enjoys seeing people suffer and going to a Christless graves? Okay, there are many going to the grave without Christ that will miss the first resurrection and be partakers of the second resurrection, which means that they will raise up just to face judgment and mm-hmm. to be destroyed again. But that's not God's plan for humanity. God brings the gospel into people's reach because he wants everybody to be saved. Mm-hmm. And this COVID-19 is supposed to cause us to reflect on our lives, cause us to see what changes need to be made. Because guess what? We are not perfect as human beings. We make mistakes, okay? The Bible says all of us like sheep have gone astray. Everyone have turned to his own way, but we don't have to remain as sheep who have gone astray. We can come back like the last sheep. If you remember, it was the good shepherd who went seeking the sheep. And that is exactly what he's doing. He's seeking his people. If you go back to the book of Genesis, you see that when Adam and Eve sinned, it was God who came down chasing after them. They were running away from God. And that's what sin does to us. Sin put nature in us that we run away from God. Okay, and towards the things that are sinful. we are not attracted to the things of God. We don't enjoy worshiping. We don't enjoy reading the Bible. This is why Jesus says in John 3:3 that we must be born again. And so when we're born again, then we start loving the things that we once hated. And the things that we once hated, we love. Okay? As the song says, the things that I used to do, I do them no more. This should be a mean of us drawing closer to God. We have all day, probably, to do nothing. It's time for us to pick up the Bible. It's time for us to God in prayer. I must commend the Prime Minister. The press release that called for 3 days of fasting and praying. The so-called Holy Week is coming up, in which Good Friday, the Holy Saturday, and the Easter Sunday, all right? And the Prime Minister sent out a press release calling for the nation to fast and pray. And the truth is, if the nation take heed and do this, I'm telling you that God has done it already. Remember Nineveh, when he was going to bring judgment on Nineveh, but he sent Jonah to go there and call the people to repentant. And when Jonah went and he took the message, the people take heed, and the king called for what? Fasting and prayer. Even the animal fasted. But what did God do? He did not bring judgment on his people. Okay, he changed, and if believers would take heed and pray, the God that was merciful and gracious to Nineveh can show mercy and grace to believers and the surrounding nation. I'm not sure what your thoughts on that.
You hear that? You hear a lot of key points there, Pastor. I believe that we have reached a point here in Belize where we only wait until we're faced with some sort of calamity where we decide to turn to God. And so I believe at this juncture, we need to, the entire country need to realize that, guess what? It's only God that's the one that has been protecting us. If you notice, we haven't faced hurricane in quite a while. And we realize that whenever we call upon God, guess what? God is going to answer. And I believe that what the Prime Minister decided to is putting out there for us to do the 3-day fast. I believe that if all of us would come together and all of us would heed the warning and realize that only God can bring a turnaround. We appreciate the doctors and what they are doing, but guess what? In the end, God is the one that is in control. And until we realize that that God is the one that's in control of everything that's taking place, then and only then we realize that, you know what? On a personal level, I need to turn back to God. I need to put my hand back in God's hand. Let him direct me and allow me to go where he wants me to go. But until then, we are going to be faced with a lot of challenges. But only God can be the one that's going to be directing us in the path that we should go, right?
So true. Now, does the Bible give any specific information regarding the nearness of Christ's second coming? We know he's coming back, but how could we know that his coming is near? Does the Bible give any type of specific information concerning that?
Mm-hmm. Well, it tells us about in the book of Matthew chapter 24, I think it gives us some different signs for us to that will be taking place, and we know that some of them already took place, where it talks about the moon got red, I think, and it talks about the sun and so forth, and and where it talks about the stars falling from heaven and so forth. We know that some of them already took place, where and it talks about earthquake in diverse places. We have seen where I have in my years on this earth, I have never heard of earthquake taking place in certain countries. And now we have seen earthquake have become a common thing, where earthquake has been taking place in different parts of the world, right? Which tells us that, you know what, the Bible is sure, right? And it tells us in the book of Matthew 24, verse 33, it says that when we see all these things, referring to the different signs, note that the coming of the Son of Man is near, right? But if we're not reading and if we're not studying for ourselves, we will be caught off guard, right? But the Bible does give us some signs and some things that we have to look out for for us to prepare ourselves for when Christ comes back. We are not caught off guard.
So true, Elashim. So true. And I would just like to elaborate on one of the signs that Jesus spoke about in Matthew chapter 24. He was speaking to his disciples in verse 2, and Jesus said to them, "Do you not see all these things? Surely I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down." And if we look at verse 16, he continues saying, "Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountain." What was Jesus talking about here? You know what he was talking about here? The disciples and Jesus was on the Mount of Olives. Jesus was giving them some signs that Jesus, just prior to his second coming. And one of the first things he was on Mount Olives, they were looking at the temple in Jerusalem that was built in Herod. It was beautiful. The sun was shining upon it. It was glittering. And Jesus said, you know what? Not one stone of this temple will be left, meaning that it's going to be destroyed. It's going to be torn down. The Jews, they honored the temple. I could almost use the word, they worshiped the temple. Right? And they never believed that a time would come when the temple would be destroyed. If that would ever happen, it would mean that the end of the world has come. Jesus told them, he said, listen, the time is coming when this temple will be destroyed, when Jerusalem will be surrounded by soldiers. It says, and whenever you see that, those who are on the housetop, not come back down. If you're in the field, not come back to the stuff. He said, run. Okay? This is the same time. He said, pray that the fight be not in the winter. Why? Because in the winter, it would have been cold. And for them to be running in that time, it would have been more difficult for them than either on Sabbath. All right? Because as you know, we should keep the Sabbath day holy. And when we say Sabbath, we're talking about Sunday. We're talking about the Bible Sabbath, which is Saturday. Okay? So the scripture shows us that Jesus warned his people. He said, whenever you see Jerusalem is surrounded by soldiers, it says, if you're on the house, if you're in the field, run. The sign that Jerusalem would have been destroyed was it would have been surrounded by soldiers. And do you know what happened? The history shows us that in AD 70, Roman armies went, surrounded Jerusalem, and the Christians remember what Jesus told them. Okay, when they saw Jerusalem surrounded by Roman soldiers, you know what they did? They ran. The fight was not a winter, neither did they have to run on the Sabbath. And do you know, not one Christian was killed. They besieged Jerusalem. The Roman soldiers besieged Jerusalem, and they stood out there for a while because Jerusalem locked them out. But it happened that they needed food. And you know what they had to do? They had to gnaw or eat the sandals, the leather of their sandals. Okay? Things got so bad. They got hungry. Also, mothers took their own babies that they carried for 9 months. And in order to try to satisfy that hunger, took their own children and roast them on altar fire and eat their flesh. Okay? That's what took place. And the Romans went in there and slaughtered man, woman, boy, and girl. They never respect gray hair. They never respect children. and blood flowed down that temple like a river, okay? But the Christians remember what Christ said, and because when they saw the sign, they acknowledge it, they recognize it, and they run. Elashane, the same thing is going to happen again. Jesus gave us some signs just before his coming, things that will be taking place. As you mentioned in Matthew chapter 24, and I believe it's verse 29, he gave some specific quickly, I just would like to read this. He says, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven will be shaken. So Jesus says, just before he comes back, the sun will be darkened, the moon will give a light, and the stars will fall from heaven. Have that taken place as yet? Some believe that it has not happened as yet. As a people, as a church, we are historicists. We believe when it comes to interpreting prophecy, that some prophecy has taken place already. Some is taking place presently, and some is yet for the future. There are those who believe that all the prophecies have taken place in the past, and there are those who believe that all is in the future. But this prophecy have happened already. That took place under the sixth seal. The sun have been darkened. The moon, that same day when it was dark, I think it was May 1980, if I'm not mistaken. I don't remember the exact date. The same night the moon came out, it was red as blood. The stars from heaven, I think it was 1833, if I'm not mistaken. Okay, so these have happened already. And if you look at the next verse after this, in verse 30, it says, then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven. And then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. So according to the Bible, we're living between verse 29 and 30. Okay? So the scripture is showing us that some of the signs have happened, some is happening presently, and some is yet to happen. All right? Any thoughts on
that? Yes. I like the fact that what the Bible explained, it gives us the idea now, it gives us the notion now that whatever the Bible has to say, that it is whatever took place and whatever is about to take place, it gives us an encouragement to know that, you know what, we're not, as Christians, we're not living to just live, right? We're not just going to church or serving God because it's a thing to do, but we're serving God because we know that he will come again, which is encouraging, right? We are serving God because we know that God does not lie when he says that he is going to prepare a place for us and that he will come back and take us with him. Right, and so it is encouraging to know that we are serving God at the point where we're preparing ourselves to know that God is coming, and Christ is coming again for us, and he will take us with him, you know. And it I find that as a means of really hopeful that whatever I go through on this earth, that guess what, it is for a purpose, it is for a reason, it's not in vain, right? And so it allows me to hold on to the faith more. It allows me to it kind of strengthen my faith in God, knowing that, you know what, I beyond this world, beyond this earth, there is something that I'm looking forward to, right? And so I'm glad that God gave us this time for us to prepare ourselves, right? That we could be ready to be with Christ when Christ comes back the second time.
Amen. Seeing these signs that is happening around us, it also talks about in the book of Luke 21, 25, and 26. It says that the earth, there would be distress of nation, perplexity, men's heart, failing them for fear, and the expectation of those things which are coming on the earth. And it is true. Many people today are living in fear. They are fearful. As human beings, it's natural for us to be fearful of the unknown. We don't want to die. The truth is we want to live and we want to live long. Even those, Ella Shane, who take their own life, the truth is they did not want to die. Do you know what all they had to do to reach that point of no return, to take their own life? Because we were not created to die. So when God created us, we were created with a probationary eternal life, to live forever. Okay? And we want to continue to live. Nobody really wants to die. Okay? And the truth is, it is not God's plan. It says, it is not his plan that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. We will continue to be fearful until we pick up the Bible for ourselves and start reading it. We will continue to be fearful until we get on our knees and start talking to God and asking God to help us. We will continue to be fearful until we come to God and acknowledge that he is greater than us and that we need him. This COVID-19 helped us to see that life is so fragile, that everything is vanity. Mm-hmm. Everything is vanity. And that's the naked truth. That's what the wise man Solomon said. He said, man, I tried drinking. I am rich. He was well-educated. He have tried so many other things that the world have to offer. And he said, man, all these things are vanity. He said, I've come to recognize that only Jesus gives true joy. Mm-hmm. Only Jesus can help us to see the true purpose of living, the true purpose of life. And many people are looking for it, but they are looking in the wrong place. Exactly. I wasn't born a Christian. I'm a sinner that is saved or being saved by the grace of Jesus Christ. But as we see these signs, as we see these things that the Bible is telling us come to pass, they should cause us to think. Don't you think so? They should cause us to reflect. They should cause us to, I wonder if this thing is really true. Right? Let's take, for example, Ella Shane, as I elaborate a little more. In the days of Noah, Noah preached for 120 years to that generation. They took him lightly. 120 years, and this man, while building the ark, preach, warning the people that, listen, a flood is coming. They have never seen rain before. So they thought this man was crazy. Some helped him build the ark. Okay? And skepticism, they teased him, they mocked him. And you know what happened? Just before the flood came, out of the blues, the animals started to walk into the ark in twos and seven, in order. If nothing else, Ella Shane, would have gotten my attention, that would have been a sign to me to consider what Noah was saying. Maybe where this man really said a true, you know. But even after the animal walked into the ark, they still hold on to their belief. Until water start fall from heaven, then they recognize that what this man was saying all the while was the truth. Okay, and the same thing is going to happen again. You know, as Seventh-day Adventists, we have been preaching that Jesus Christ is coming back for so long, 70 odd years. We have been preaching that Jesus is coming back. And people say, man, they not come as yet. How long haven't we been telling people that not every animal will move good for eat? Ella Shane, I was thinking about that.
Yeah.
Where did COVID-19 originate from? The eating of the same animals that Jesus said we're not supposed to eat. If we would have followed what the Bible says, we never may in this mess tonight. Right? But thank God for his word and thank God that he gives us warning and he's patient with us, okay? But in spite of the mess that we're in, people still continue still mm-hmm. continue and mm-hmm. pay no mind to what God is saying when God is really trying to get their attention.
Exactly. And you know, Pastor, today it's been a, we have, right now, we're on lockdown. I have been inside for quite some while, my family and I. And so today we had the opportunity to actually, we had to do a quick run out to pick up one or two stuff. And so while we were driving, while I was driving, you know, my wife and I, we looked at each other. We were like, man, it really feels good to be out. I have been going to work every day. And I didn't realize that I took for granted of the opportunity of just being, not just in my yard, but being moving further than just in my yard. I took that for granted. And so while we were out driving, I was like, man, this really feels good. You know, we have been locked up for a couple of days and I'm like, this really feels good. And so it's the same thing when it comes to God and God's word. There are times we take God's word for granted. And we have been sharing and telling people about God and Christ is coming back and prepare yourself and do this. And people are looking at us like Noah, as though we're just talking out of our heads. And as though we're just talking because we want to talk and we want to get them baptized and we want to do this. But a time will come where God's word, the word that we were giving them for free, a time will come where they will want to hear it. But it won't be available at the time. And so when I look at that, it brings me to the fact to tie that in where we took things for granted until it's actually taken from us, right? That's when we realize how much value it is. And the same thing with God's word. When we have God's word, right now we can study, and a time will come where we won't have it like that. We can't fellowship like we want. And so that's when we're going to realize, you know what, man, I didn't realize that spending time in God's word, spending time in fellowship would have been so valuable, you know, encouraging. And so when I think about that, I'm like, we are spending time sharing with God, with people, and people are taking us for granted, not realizing like Noah, where a time will come where they won't have an opportunity to actually hear a portion of God's word. And so I want to tell people, you know, while we have the time, let's spend time in God's word. Let's realize that God's word is going to be a means of encouragement. A time will come where we won't have it, right? We won't be able to share it publicly, not even using Facebook, right? But while we can, while we have the time, let's share while we can with each other.
Amen. And you said it right. There will come a time, the scripture said, there will be a famine for mm-hmm. the word of God. Okay? You know, I'm convinced, Ella Shane, despite the majority of the world seem to be indifferent mm-hmm. concerning God's word and the things of God. They don't have an interest. In fact, that's one of the signs of the last days. Mm-hmm. In Second Timothy, I believe it is, where it says that people will be lovers of pleasures mm-hmm. more than that. All right. Instead of people seeking God, they want the things of pleasure. In other words, a bar room and the place of parties full, the churches are empty. Okay, mm-hmm. people would rather pick up their phones and rather than pick up the word of God, or pick up the remote rather than picking up the word of God. Okay, we're living in that time, just as it was in the days of Noah. Okay, mm-hmm. in the days of Noah, the scripture says in Matthew that in the days of Noah, they were marrying and giving in marriage and drinking. Nothing is wrong in getting married. But the scripture was emphasizing that people did not have God in their minds. Mm-hmm. Their mind was on everything else. They throw party for everything. Mm-hmm. We're living in a time that it seems as though people can't wait for your dead so that they could have mm-hmm. 1 week, so that we could have free liquor, free food and music there. That's the time that we're living in. okay? Mm-hmm. People party for anything. They have lobster fest. They have fest for everything, okay? All they're simply saying that they want an opportunity for party, all right? Mm-hmm. Do not have God in their mind. That's mm-hmm. the time that we're living in. People are lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. But I thank God that God will also have, even though it's going to be the minority, God have his people out there. God have people out there. I believe there are people out there that is seeking for God. Mm-hmm. There is people out there right now who might not live the way God wants them to live because they don't know better, but they are seeking for truth. And this is why I believe that we as a people try to preach truth and preach Christ so that the searcher that is out there that is seeking Christ could know that Jesus loves them and he wants to save them. Mm-hmm. Because I was there. I could remember it was at a wake that I went. And there was a brother there that was sharing out Bibles. There, I got one of the Bible and started to read the Bible. I was high at that week, high on weed, high on liquor, okay? But God knew deep down in my heart that I was a seeker for truth, that my outward appearance and action wasn't the reality of what really was in my heart. Deep down in my heart, I wanted to serve God. I wanted to do what is right. And there are many more out there. There are many more that is drinking and smoking and doing the things that are contrary to God, that really wants God. And the good news of salvation is that God invites us to come to him so that he can forgive us and give us a new life in him. And he can create in us clean hearts and take our sins and throw them into the depths of the sea and make a new person out of us and prepare us for his second coming. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. We have 5 minutes more, Lashim.
And
any other point you'd like to stress on
that? It gives you a hope to know that, you know, there are people out there who might be saying to themselves, but I'm the worst person. I have been doing this. I have been doing that. I have been doing this. I don't want to put it like this. There is nothing worse that any of us could do when we match up ourselves with what Lucifer did in heaven. I don't think anything that any of us do on earth can be compared to what he have done in heaven. And so when we look at ourselves and we try to bring ourselves down and we try to say to ourselves, you know what? God won't listen to me. I'm the worst person I have done. Guess what? If he could have tried to give Lucifer a second chance, knowing that Lucifer, what he have done in heaven, what about us? And so it doesn't matter what we have done. It doesn't matter how far we might feel away from God. It doesn't matter if we have committed murder or whatever we have done. Guess what? God is the same merciful God. He's still the same God that always want to forgive us. But the part is that we ourselves, we don't want to forgive ourselves. Right? And if we can't forgive ourselves, and it will push us far away from God. And here tonight, God is telling us that, guess what? I'm the same God that was yesterday and today and forever. It doesn't matter what we have done, but guess what? We need to come, like what you have said, Pastor, we need to come to God and ask God, and what, Lord, I have done this. But I believe that if I trust in you and I put my faith in you are going to forgive me of what I've done. And so when it comes to us, and we compare the back in Noah's time, one of the things that has struck me, Pastor, is that the fact that even though we're faced with this dilemma of COVID-19, we're still seeing people committing murder. And this is a point where, as a nation, we should come together and unite together. But there are people who are still out there doing things that is contrary. Hence the reason where it talks about there are people who they won't have any love for each other. right? And they are just craving for the material thing. When we go to heaven, we will have more in heaven than what we have here on earth, which is encouraging for me.
So true, Elder Shea. So true. Very good points that you brought out there. Jesus says that in an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh.
Mm-hmm.
So he said, watch therefore and pray.
Mm-hmm.
Because in an hour as you think not, he's coming. We do not know the exact day and hour. We are not time setters. But we can look at the signs. Mm-hmm. We can look around us and see an increase in crime and violence. We can see just recently the government decriminalized homosexuality and lesbianism. And even though it's accepted by men, God state that it is an abomination. Mm-hmm. And even though you would find out that the rulers of the earth may agree to it, it is still wrong before God, okay? Mm-hmm. There is an increase when it comes with natural disasters. Mm-hmm. I've never seen so much earthquake, hurricanes, tornadoes, causing people to lose their life, loss of property. There have been an increase in knowledge. That's in Daniel chapter 12 and verse 4. It says that in the last days, there will be an increase in knowledge, and us using technology as a mean to preach the gospel is a proof that that prophecy is true. And not only is talking about the knowledge and the wisdom of the world, but an increase in the knowledge of the Bible. There was a time that we could not understand certain prophecies. For example, the prophecies of Daniel and Revelation. These prophecies are relevant for us for today. And at one time, we couldn't understand. In fact, there are even preachers today who call these book closed book that we cannot understand them. You notice they are not preached that much, but knowledge has increased that God have allowed us in these last days to understand these prophecies. And so I want to appeal to those who are listening. It's time for us to get back and start studying these prophecies and see exactly what God is telling us, what has happened, what is happening, and what is yet about to happen. Because if you think this COVID-19 is the end of it, you better think again and get in this book and start prayerfully studying it, and you will see that this is just the beginning of what is yet to come. But the people of God, people of Jesus that have a relationship with him, he will lead them and guide them and give them that peace, and he will save his people. Because the plan of God is not for you to be lost, it's for you to be saved. And despite who you are tonight, what you have done, the mistakes you have made in life, we can find forgiveness with Christ. He's a God of second chances. Tonight, you might feel as though your life is coming to an end. It is in a mess. There is no way nobody can help you. You have tried talking to others. You have tried drinking. Some people have even think about committing suicide. You have tried everything else. It's time for you to give Jesus a try. You can't say that he did not help you if you don't give him a try. You see, the problem in our world tonight, it's not a COVID-19 problem. It's not even a gang problem. It's not a problem with finance and corruption. Our problem in our world tonight is a sin problem. And nobody has the answer to sin but Jesus Christ. And so we must come to him and ask him to help us. He says, come as you are. Come unto me, he says, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And I thank God that we can come to Jesus. So what I want to invite you to do right where you are is bow your heads with me. I'm going to ask Elder Shane to close us off in a word of prayer as we close tonight.
Let us pray. Father, who art in heaven, as we come before you tonight, dear Lord, we want to thank you so much for the opportunity we have of sharing your word, dear Lord. Father, it's encouraging to know, dear Lord, that your coming is near and your coming is sure, dear Lord. Dear God, I continue to ask and pray that you may continue to be with us, that you may continue to help us, dear Lord, that we may be ready for when you come. Dear God, I am asking special prayer for all those who are listening to us tonight. Dear Lord, maybe somebody that is listening to us tonight, dear God, might feel as though they are far away from God. Might feel as though that they are the worst person, dear Lord. But I ask and pray, dear Lord, that you may touch their heart. That tonight might not be just another Bible study night, dear Lord, but tonight might be a means of them drawing closer to you, dear Lord. Dear Lord, I want to remember all those who are sick with this virus, who have been affected, whether it be infected or affected financially, or those who have lost a loved one, dear God, tonight we want to lift them up to you, dear Lord. Father, we know that it is not easy, dear Lord, when you're faced with a difficult situation, dear God. And so tonight we want to put them into your hands, dear Lord, that you may continue to work on them, dear Lord. Father, we know that there are countries, dear God, Belize is one of them. At this point, dear Lord, we are searching for answers. We have our leaders, dear God, who are at the point of questioning certain things, dear God. And so tonight we want to lift them up, dear Lord, that as they seek you, that they may realize, dear God, like what Pastor Andrew had just said, it's not about the COVID-19. It's not about the violence that is taking place in our country. But, dear God, it's about sin, dear Lord. Father, until we subject ourselves to you, then and only then we realize that all these things are a result of sin. I ask and pray, dear Lord, that you may help us, that as we draw close to the Lord, that we may see our true nature. I ask, dear God, that you may cover us with your robe of righteousness, dear Lord. Father, you said that you don't want any one of us to be lost, but that all of us may come to repentance, dear Lord, and know more of you. I pray all these in your Son, precious and holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Beloved friend of mine, thank you guys for listening. And we pray that God will bless you, cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you, and that the Lord will give you peace. Okay? We want you to know that Wednesday night, we're going to be here at 7 o'clock. We have a special program planned for you. So we want to ask you to join us at 7. And also, you can invite your friends and family. You have a good night now. God bless and keep you. Thank you.